Sure. The key thing for your viewers to understand is that when they see intermittent fasting is an eating pattern. It's not a diet. Oftentimes, in kind of the lay press and so on, intermittent fasting will be lumped in as a diet, but it's not a diet. It's an eating pattern. A diet is what you eat and how much you eat. Intermittent fasting is an eating pattern that includes intermittent periods of not eating sufficient to deplete the glucose stores in the liver and cause a switch to the use of fats from your fat cells and the ketones produced from those fat cells. So in a person that eats breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and doesn't get much exercise, every time they eat, they're replenishing the glucose stores in the liver, and they may never tap in to the fat stores, and therefore their ketone levels will remain low because the metabolic switch hasn't occurred. It typically takes at least 10 hours to deplete the glucose in the liver. So if a person eats breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and then has a snack around 8 or 9 o'clock, they may get up and eat breakfast and have not depleted the energy in their liver and have not switched to using fat. So with intermittent fasting, the approaches that have been used in experimental studies, both in animals and humans, are as follows. One is called daily time-restricted eating, where the time window that one eats is compressed into, say, a 6 to 8 hour time period. So that means the person would be fasting for 16 to 18 hours, which is a sufficient time for this metabolic switch to have occurred. And scientists think, based on a lot of data, that this metabolic switching is important for health benefits of intermittent fasting, but also maybe even of exercise in some instances. So daily time-restricted eating is one approach that can result in daily metabolic switching, daily elevation in ketones. So for example, if a person skips breakfast, eats all their food between noon and 6 p.m., and if they were to measure their ketones, they'll find that in the morning, they'll start to be elevated. Okay. If they wake up and go for a run in the morning, they're already at or in, the metabolic switch has already occurred. So they can actually enhance the effect of the fasting in terms of elevation of ketones. And we think in terms of beneficial effects on the brain, the cardiovascular system, perhaps even physical performance, which is an area that's being studied now with intermittent fasting. There's very strong evidence that compared to 3 meals a day plus snacks, intermittent fasting is beneficial for the heart, the brain, glucose regulation, but it's not completely clear yet whether it's beneficial for athletic performance. There's a lot of interest in that. Okay, so let's get back to intermittent fasting eating patterns. Another intermittent fasting eating pattern is one that's now called 5-2 intermittent fasting. And this is where the individual, 2 days a week, they'll only eat one moderate-sized meal of, say, 600 calories those 2 days. Then the other 5 days, they eat normally. And so in that case, 5-2 intermittent fasting, the person will have the metabolic switching occurring 2 days a week, but not the other five. In fact, there was this 5-2 intermittent fasting, in a sense, kind of triggered the popularization of intermittent fasting. And I'll just take a few minutes to kind of give a historical perspective. We'd done a lot of work in the 1990s and early 2000s showing that intermittent fasting was beneficial for the brains of animals. And we can talk about that, some details on that. And then we'd also published some work on intermittent fasting, reducing resting heart rate and blood pressure, and having anti-inflammatory effects. And then I was approached by a number of clinical investigators. One was Jim Johnson, who worked with asthma patients. And we, in 2007, we published a small study where we found that these were overweight asthma patients, and we put them on a really rigorous regimen where every other day they only ate 400 calories. So that's not something that can be maintained as a lifestyle, because it's very hard to maintain your body weight with that. But in these overweight asthma patients, over 2 months, it had profound beneficial effects in improving their symptoms, their airflow in their lungs. My lab, we measured indicators of oxidative stress and inflammation in the blood, which went down, not right away, but between 2 and 4 weeks of initiating that every other day metabolic switching regimen. Okay, so we published that study. Then I was approached by Michelle Harvey, who's in England and works with women at risk for breast cancer because of their overweight, and they also have a family history. And she came to my lab. She'd seen our work in animals. And there's also some work in animals suggesting that fasting can be beneficial in suppressing cancer growth. So anyway, Michelle and I designed a study where we took these women, 100 women, and we randomly assigned them to either what's now called 5-2 intermittent fasting, or we had a control group where we had them eat breakfast, lunch, and dinner, but each meal had 25% fewer calories than they'd normally take in. And because we'd done a calculation that the long-term calorie intake would be similar in the two groups, the group eating 600 calories 2 days a week versus the group eating 3 meals every day but reducing their calorie intake. Over 6 months, both groups of women lost about 8% of their initial body weight, and both groups had improvements in glucose regulation and other health indicators. But the women on 5-2 intermittent fasting had a greater improvement in insulin sensitivity and lost more belly fat compared to the group that was counting calories, if you will, every meal.